Coming up on Tech News Today, Microsoft wants to throttle Google after one of Google's researchers reveals an XP vulnerability. Sprint wants to throttle your data, and you get to throttle people in Mortal Kombat. Fatalities are back. All that and more coming up.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Tech News Today is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Tech News Today for Friday, June 11th, 2010. Tech News Today is brought to you by Slingbox. Watch your favorite TV shows when you're away from home with Slingbox. Check out Slingbox at a Best Buy near you or at slingbox.com. Welcome to Tech News Today. I'm Tom Merritt.
And I'm Sarah Lane.
And behind the board's Eric Lanigan. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you guys?
You are triumphant today, according to my script.
Oh, I have triumphed.
Yeah. There's
I don't know what, but
more adjectives than you can shake a stick at. This is the show where we kick around the tech news of the day along with you and try to make some sense out of it all. Starting off with a story about a Google researcher issuing a how-to on how to attack Windows XP.
Which is kind of a funny story because it works for Google, but this wasn't like Google, the company, has issued any sort of a statement. It's somebody that works within the company, I think in Switzerland, and apparently found a vulnerability, a big one, within XP, let Microsoft know about it,
Yes. Said,
hey, here, send an email. I don't know if he made a phone call or not, but he sent an email, which he says had at least been received. He got a receipt, something like that.
Confirmation of receipt.
And in 5 days, nothing had changed. So he posted it online. He posted what his findings were, and apparently Microsoft is not too happy about this whole thing.
No, Microsoft's, I would venture to say Microsoft's pissed.
Yeah, Microsoft's pissed. It makes them look bad.
TG Daily says they're angry. They've criticized the Google researcher, it was a Google engineer, for publicly disclosing the remote code execution vulnerability affecting Windows XP on the full disclosure mailing list. And this is an ongoing debate in the security community. I know William Gibson talks about it a lot on Security Now.
Steve Gibson.
William Gibson talks about it a lot, probably in his house while he's writing his science fiction novel. Sorry, Steve. Thank you for correcting that.
That's though. All right.
Steve talks about it a lot, and it's responsible disclosure. Like, and the point of this is the bad guys already know this vulnerability.
Right.
Almost all the time when these vulnerabilities are found, they're already being used and exploited.
Sure.
So you go to the company and you say, hey, I found this vulnerability in Windows XP, and you expect them to fix it. If they don't, what are you supposed to do? The companies will drag you along for months sometimes saying, no, we're working on it.
Right. Because
don't
at that
put
point,
it out there.
If you stay quiet, then you can feel irresponsible. And some would argue that you are being irresponsible by not letting the general public know what's going on.
Right. So this Google engineer in this case, on the full disclosure, put it out there, put a possible fix out there, which Secunia has said, actually, there's a way around your fix, so they need to tighten it up.
Yeah, that's part of Microsoft's reasoning, like, hey, your workaround, or your fix isn't even really a fix.
Your fix sucks.
Your fix is not good enough for us. I'd like to know how long Microsoft does need. 5 days is not enough, apparently. How long do they need? Do they need 7?
It's not even so much.
14?
Yeah, I mean, it can take, especially in a big company like that, it can take a long time to get stuff done. It's that the communication isn't happening.
Right.
And that's where the debate is like, look, if you're not going to work with me and really let me know how this is going, I'm just going to put it out there in the public.
So what do you think? Do you think that he should have kept quiet, or do you think he did?
No, I am of the mind that the more we know, the better.
Yeah.
So I think he did exactly the right thing. And I know he's trying to make a point by putting this out in 5 days. So maybe he could have waited a little longer. But I think he needs to force the issue. And I think this is a good thing.
Me too. Microsoft is also, it is a big company. And I know big companies things can slow down. But they also have a lot of folks working there.
Now, that vulnerability is actually a lot more serious than the iPad vulnerability we talked about yesterday.
Crazy iPad breach.
Yeah.
Lets you know what Tom Cruise's email address might be.
Or Rahm Emanuel.
PR guy reads.
Yeah. These are, as we mentioned yesterday, these are addresses you could probably guess in most cases because they're, you know, whitehouse.gov or newyorktimes.com.
This is not a social security number
right,
where you've really got some privacy issues. Email addresses, I've had many throughout the years.
However,
just kinda stop using them.
Because it's important people and the iPad involved, the FCC said it would step up scrutiny of online security and privacy issues following these recent security breaches, announcing on Friday that it had opened a probe into a security breach, calling in the FBI, and so they're on the case.
The FBI has been called. iPad, you've been hearing about this iPad, right? Well, it's a dangerous machine.
Yeah. Well, you know,
Mom's email address is out there for everyone to see.
Probably an FBI person's email address was in there.
Probably.
What I find interesting is the FCC all of a sudden is starting to do all these things. It's like, do they really have the manpower to do that? And if they did, what have they been doing so far? You know, why haven't they been launching all these investigations before?
The incident appeared to be a classic security breach that has happened to many companies. Yes, exactly.
I think it's because the iPad is one of these devices that a lot of, I don't know, if you want to call them normal people, you know, it's not really a geeky thing. It's a everybody machine.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, the general public is...
Those security issues you've been railing about for years, they're like, wait, that happened to me? Oh, no.
I'm no
geek. This is important now.
This is really an issue.
Yeah, this is a bunch of hot air. But who knows? Maybe good will come up. Digitimes reporting that Foxconn and Flextronics say they will begin shipping Project Natal to Microsoft in August.
Although, if you're very, very excited about this news, they also go on to say most of the shipping is not going to happen until next year.
Yeah, they will
start the beginning of shipping.
They will start shipping in August. Mass shipments are estimated to start in 2011. So we'll find this out on Monday.
Right.
Probably when this will actually come out. But if they're starting to ship in August, does that mean we could see it before the end of the year? Or if mass shipment's not starting until 2011, does that mean they miss the holiday season? I can't imagine them missing the holiday season with Project
Natal. That's a good point. I think we could speculate for hours about this, or we could wait till the keynote on Monday.
We will probably just need to wait till the keynote on Monday. But these Foxconn leaks on Digitimes are almost always right on. So sometime after August, but before the end of 2011.
What if it's Christmas season of 2011? Well, that's just nuts.
No, that's way too late. Nah. Isn't it? We'll find out Monday.
I'd like to see something before that.
All right, we got bad news for Sprint customers, but first I got to tell you that this episode is brought to you by Slingbox.com. This is brought to you by Slingbox. Slingbox lets you watch your home TV. You can find them at Slingbox.com. You watch your home TV anywhere you go and on most any portable device, iPhone, iPod Touch, Wi-Fi, BlackBerry, laptop, MacBook. I used it last year during World of Warcraft's, during Blizzard's BlizzCon, to watch BlizzCon that I had paid for on DirecTV on my iPhone while I was walking the dog and at the gym. So you can make the full use of that pay-per-view if you got Slingbox. You go to Best Buy, purchase a Slingbox, bring it home. You hook up your Slingbox to your TV and internet connection, and then you can watch your TV on your mobile phone or laptop wherever you go, wherever you're connected to the internet. You can watch all the TV that you subscribe to, anything off your DVR, pre-recorded shows, anything. So check out Slingbox at a Best Buy near you, or at slingbox.com/twit.
Hey, Slingbox.
So what is this bad news for the Sprint with the throttling and the such?
Well, apparently, people don't like to read fine print. I don't like to read fine print particularly. It's not something I think is a lot of fun.
Nobody likes to read fine print.
Yeah, well, apparently there's a little fine print that you would have perhaps missed if you've got a contract with Sprint. And apparently, Sprint has the capability to begin throttling data, meaning that they can kind of pull back on data to make sure that their network stays more sort of, I guess, not secure, but, you know, there's not as much of
uncongested.
Uncongested. So the AT&T problems that we all complain about.
I would like to throttle my sinuses right now.
Me too.
Actually.
I feel like I'm speaking through cotton or something.
So if you're starting to use too much data, basically, they cut it back.
Yeah, so you can think of it sort of two different ways. It's like Sprint is sort of trying to keep this all sort of regulated, not have a lot of the drops that we all complain about, but at the same time, you sort of suffer if you want to be in control of the data usage that you're going to be using.
So different than AT&T, where if you go over, you just have to buy a new block.
Right.
This, you'll never go over. You never have to pay more. You just have to wait, as if you're on a dial-up modem.
I tend to not, even though I don't particularly like going over any sort of plan and paying more, I like to feel like I'm in control of that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you want the ability to go over.
Be nice if you had both choices. If you said, yes, like,
ooh,
you're about to go over,
nice,
would you like to buy a new block or be throttled?
There you go.
I like that too.
Yeah.
Why don't they just do that? What's the problem?
It's too complicated.
It's too much choicing. I don't, it's sort of like if you go over something, you have no one to blame but yourself. I'm certainly not going to blame Sprint if they were to say, listen, if you want to go over, you go ahead, but you're going to pay more. Fine. I understand that. I think we all do. So data throttling, I think probably there's a lot of people on both sides.
And we should say this is not an official announcement yet. This is actually a tipster who told Thomas Ricker at Engadget, sent him a screenshot from Sprint's playbook that points out that data throttling is coming. So if that image is correct,
it's more data throttling is coming.
Data throttling coming?
Sources say possibly.
What is actually there for sure is a Google News experiment that promotes serendipity.
Right.
With editor's picks. So instead of just getting your algorithm created page of news, there's some editor's picks at the top of what some smart ivory tower editor thinks I should read.
Right. So if you're wondering, well, I don't see this on my Google News page. Well, I don't either, because it's only been rolled out to a small amount of folks. The reason that people are sort of like, well, what's going on here is that Google has always kind of touted itself as, they're an algorithmic operation. They're not a bunch of humans telling us what news is important. It's all very, I guess, democratic in the internet sense way of doing things. And it's all a bunch of numbers and robots and this and that. So the idea of now editors handpicking our news for us, at least just a small portion of it, some people go, well, wait a second. I mean, this is not what Google's about. But at the same time,
this is just stealing a page from TechMeme, right?
Right. TechMeme does this.
Yeah.
A lot of, Dig to a certain extent. I mean, there's nothing, a pure algorithm, I mean, even certain parts of the algorithm are weighted so that
nothing is pure is what you're saying.
Exactly. That's exactly what I'm saying. I don't even know how these algorithms work, really, but well, I know that they're not.
Google says this is just an experiment. They do experiments all the time. They don't know if this is going to work out or not. It doesn't indicate anything. Everyone just stopped freaking out about it. But then over at Search Engine Land, Matt McGee got inducted into some beta test of a new Google News layout that's more bloggish.
Yeah, he was actually, he was looking for what I was looking for. I was like, hey, can we see these cherry-picked news stories? Well, he didn't have that feature either, but he said, wait a second, my whole news layout is completely different. Left side is sort of, it's almost like a left container for a blog entry, and then a right sidebar, which is a lot more smashed down, rather than, it used to be sort of two columns that were equally, equal in horizontal width. So I don't have that either, but he's got a screenshot of it and it's kind of,
I've had it up. Let me get it back up here.
Now we're just looking on our end. I like it. I like the way it looks. I don't actually go, to the, now do we have, okay, so this is the original.
That's what it looks
this
like
is
now.
This what it looks like for me still.
And if you scroll farther down, Eric.
If you go down, keep going.
Oh, way down, You're way far away.
It stops right there.
Oh.
Not?
Let me try back to the article.
There
we go.
There's this.
Yeah,
oh,
there
so
we
it's
go.
Two different images. Yeah, so if you look at that, I mean, well, I wouldn't say it looks just like a blog, but it's got a bit more of a, I don't know, it's like somebody with an eye for design kind of went through and changed a few things.
Yeah, it's just a little cleaner layout. I don't think
Do you go to the Google News page with regularity, Tom?
I do. Actually, I look at it every day. Because it's got a little different selection,
right?
Because of the algorithm of news, I'll find a couple things that I don't see other places.
Yeah, I agree with you. I don't have a problem with a few editor's picks here and there, as long as I know that they're different.
I like that it's separated.
Else.
I think that's a good idea.
Yeah, me too.
Mortal Kombat making a return to 2D.
Mortal Kombat!
Hot off the heels of the strange and violent Mortal Kombat short film, says Ars Technica, the new game, simply called Mortal Kombat, looks to be a very, very welcome return, according to Ars Technica. Not only will it feature traditional 2D fighting, but it'll also see the return of fatalities! Yes!
So
finish him.
Can I just be an idiot for a second? Why were fatalities taken away in the first place?
Because they're
so
violent.
People just shook each other's hand at the end and walked away.
Kids shouldn't be seeing that.
It was about the kids.
It's all about the children.
Can't you label it M for mature and be done with it?
That's exactly where we are with this, actually. And I think that's what's so interesting about it is back in the day, Mortal Kombat was a huge controversy because of the fatalities. And now, in this day and age, we can actually put it out as an adult game and say, you know what? This is not meant for kids.
Right.
The games have grown up.
Yes.
And yet they're going back to 2D. So many of these classic franchises are going back to 2D. You got New Super Mario Bros. You got Sonic the Hedgehog is going back to 2D. Now Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, it's the nostalgia move.
Is that all it is? I mean, it's nostalgia for adults.
I think it's a little bit, yeah.
I mean, of course it's a little bit.
Because we all played Mortal Kombat as kids, and now we want to play it in that same way.
Yeah, right. But I think a lot of these franchises did not make it well in 3D. The gameplay was there in 2D. They tried to branch out into 3D just on their name alone, their brand name. And the games were just not very good.
So it's a little bit of a nostalgia for all you people who used to like the old game because our new technology really didn't work that well.
Exactly.
Yeah.
10 years later.
Also nostalgic is tape storage.
Tape storage.
Staples Technology, according to Channel Insider, says that they're seeing growth in people buying tape storage for nearline and offline storage. Nearline means you don't access the data very often.
Right.
So you don't need to have it constantly accessible. And offline just means, you know what, you stick it in our closet.
When I first read the story, I thought, okay, I haven't used anything tape-ish that I can think of in a number of years. Who else is doing that? But a lot of people, actually. For example, if you think of the medical industry, that's a great example. It had never crossed my mind that medical facilities, well, I mean, if somebody would have said so, I probably wouldn't have disagreed with them, but medical facilities, data-heavy medical records, MRIs, CAT scans, things of that nature, all on tape.
This is so funny because we had just been, David Randolph of Snader was here helping us with our SAN, and he was just showing us today these tape backups that are built into these NASAs you can buy. And he was actually saying that he, in his opinion, tape is the best long-term archival storage because there are no moving parts. He says hard drives have a 50% failure rate if you go to pull them off a shelf if they've been not spinning for so long. And he says tape, most reliable and cheapest.
But it's subject to environmental degradation.
I would think so, yeah.
That sort of thing.
I guess the key word is cheap. You know, banks are backing up a lot of data.
Yeah. Massive tapes. Data. Yeah.
In these troubled times, drink. we want to save money and use tape.
Keeping costs down with.
I can't
with
see
a
this
lot
being a long term trend, right?
Well, it's funny because so this is Staples Technology Solutions, which is not exactly the same as Staples, the retail store, but it's the same umbrella company. Yeah, they're sort of like, listen. The whole demise of tape, not happening. Lots of people still using tape. But I think we'll see a general drop-off.
Hey, we brought back the 2D games. Why not bring back the tape?
Everything's coming back.
VHS!
Yeah! Woo! Mini disc. That's different.
MIT has got promise for the future. This is new. This is not taking something from an old page. This is 3D TV without the glasses.
Tom, how does that work?
Well, let me tell you. There's a lens in the projector, and it's thinner at the bottom than on the top. Steers light to a viewer's eye by switching light-emitting diodes along its bottom edge on and off. Combined with the backlight, according to this MIT article, this makes it possible to show different images to different viewers or create a stereoscopic 3D effect. Now, they've figured out how to use cameras to track the eyeballs of up to two people so that they can change that image enough so that those two people continue to see 3D no matter where they're sitting. They've been able to do 3D without glasses before, but it had to be one viewer sitting in an exact location. Not terribly useful for the mass audience.
Not in a living
room. So this is a big advance where they're able to say, okay, we can handle more than one viewer.
Right.
And they can be pretty much, I mean, within a range.
Well, only one
viewer
meaning two viewers. So you still can't have a Super Bowl party at your house and have everybody watching the game in 3D.
This is good for romantic comedies.
A nice romantic Super Bowl
movies.
Two.
A romantic Super Bowl viewing, yes.
The two people can sit a number of places on the couch.
But well, the funny thing also, it says somehow the way this works, the way it flickers and aligns to the individual person's eyes, you can have four people sitting on the same couch watching the same TV set, and all watching a different show.
Right, not in 3D.
Right, in 2D.
Right, because, you know, for 3D, you need two eyes, basically images going to one through each eye. You could do a standard signal or a high-def signal to four different people all watching different things.
And I can't think of one practical reason to do that, except the fact that if it's possible, it's kind of
cool. Because it's awesome.
Because it's awesome.
Yeah.
The 3D without the glasses, I mean, obviously, they got a long way to go. We all, I started hearing about 3D. In fact, I used Super Bowl as an example because I remember it got thrown out there. And it was like, am I supposed to be watching Sunday, night football in my living room with 3D glasses? Because I'm not going to do that. I'm just not going to. So I like the idea of not having to wear glasses, but there still seem to be quite a few limitations. It's cool to see how it's coming along, but it's not there yet.
And last but not least, I know Eric and Sarah don't care as much about this, but I know some of you in the audience might. SCO is done for. SCO, if you remember back when we talked about it on the Screensavers in 2002.
Which I don't, even though I worked there.
SCO is the company who claimed they had a patent on some Unix stuff. They were going to drive Linux out of business. They were gonna charge people to make any kind of Linux variant. They lost in court. We thought they were done. Then they came back with an appeal. They got some funding, fought back. The zombie rose back up, but the judge has refused to hear their appeal case, letting the previous court stand. So the previous court's decision that SCO doesn't have a leg to stand on is the end of
it. So they could, I guess they could appeal again, but at this point, it's just a waste of money. And everyone kind of thinks that the whole...
Well, it was a waste of money like 5 years ago, but right. That didn't stop them then.
A continuation of a waste of money. I mean, how many times do you appeal, really, before you go, all right.
Your Linux is now safe, ladies and gentlemen. Congratulations.
R.I.P. SCO.
All right, let's move on to our voicemails. And we've got one here. My computer crashed on me.
Oh.
But who is it that we've got?
Tim in Ohio.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tim in, and now we actually kind of tracked him down. He didn't want to tell us what town, city he was from in Ohio.
But Google Voice does tell us.
But Google Voice told us.
Should we unmask him?
Well, you were, it's something with a Z.
Zanesville, Ohio. Okay. Well, at least that's where his phone is.
You've actually been
to
Zanesville.
I've eaten at the Red Lobster in Zanesville.
And you said it was very nice.
It's quite lovely. Yeah.
So, Tim, be proud. Be proud of your town. Zanesville for life.
You're like, I'm not from Zanesville.
Never.
Google Voice totally
Google
got it
Voice
wrong.
Google Voice is wrong. It's 40 miles from where I live. Yeah.
Anyway, he's got some thoughts on the Google Wi-Fi and whether Google should be liable for the collection of data. When they were walking around or running around with their trucks. Let's listen.
Hey, TNT crew. This is Tim in Ohio. I'm calling about the Google Wi-Fi issue. Anybody using Wi-Fi without encryption is broadcasting their data for anyone else within range to see. This is no different than somebody else recording a conversation between two people that are using regular walkie-talkies without encryption. There cannot be an expectation of privacy unless you are using encryption. Love the show.
Now, that's kind of where I was going with this the other day. Some people have said it's like, well, if you don't lock the door to your house, does that mean thieves can come in and take anything they want?
Right. I mean, he's right. Of course, that's what you get when you have an unencrypted network. But Google and somebody recording a conversation without your knowing, I mean, that's sort of that's apples and oranges kind of, I mean, Google saying, hey, we got all this stuff by mistake, we didn't mean to, that's a little different than somebody camping out outside of a cafe and stealing a...
Let's suppose worst case scenario. Let's suppose that Google did have, obviously not malicious intent, but they really wanted to collect this data and use it for something in a way people would thought would break their privacy. What would they have used it for?
I don't have a clue.
I don't think Google.
I mean,
cares
I guess. I mean, data mining.
At all.
Data. There's all kinds of reasons you can have data. You can have data mining payoff. They certainly could target ads at people. I guess if they knew a lot about what kind of
based on a snippet.
But there's
of
so many easier ways to get that information.
Yeah.
And I mean, Google uses with Google Toolbar and stuff like that. Why would they?
Google wasn't doing that.
What's their What's their motivation?
Right,
it's bizarre because now all these European courts are saying that there was clearly intent to steal this data. saying that it's not even true, that it was an accident, that bit of code was left in there.
And right. they're actually combining all of their the lawsuit. Google's trying to get all the lawsuits combined in one.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
So that was announced today, too.
Let's just do this once.
They're like, look, you know what? If we're going to have this conversation, we don't want to have it over and over again. Can you just all bring one lawsuit against us so we can get this over with?
Yeah, really.
Because it is different than having your house unlocked. If you're broadcasting Wi-Fi, you're shining a light, right? You're sending something out into the world away from your property.
Mm-hmm.
And so you should probably take some responsibility for that, right?
Now, what were you telling me earlier about Finland?
Yeah, Finland.
Where in Finland, it's actually, anybody can have an unencrypted network and share it with whoever, but it's illegal to use that network without asking permission.
It's illegal to use someone else's unencrypted network.
Right.
They're actually getting rid of that law.
Oh.
They're saying, you know what? That's ridiculous.
Well, it's polite.
They're going to legalize use of unsecured Wi-Fi. And so they're saying, they're going to say, you know what? Fine. If you unsecure your Wi-Fi, you're saying anybody can use it.
Which is what everyone else is already saying.
As long as we all play by the same rules, that's all I care about.
Welcome to today, Finland.
On to the calendar.
Yeah. So, you know, this morning I woke up and had to move my car because I live in San Francisco and that's what happens because there's street cleaning on every block of every corner.
Every minute of every day.
Somewhere I will get a ticket for parking my car on the street. Anyway, so I was out on the street about 8 a.m. and there are people running around in soccer jerseys yelling, ole, ole, ole. It's World Cup fever out there.
Well, yeah, because Mexico played South Africa in the
opener.
Right. It was the first game.
It was the first game, and people were up drinking, hanging out, running around. Beautiful day outside. But not just in real life, not just at the bars. World Cup is crazy online.
Yeah.
There's a million different ways to watch the World Cup. You can watch it. You watch the game streaming. ESPN is doing that for folks. Although you have to be your ISP. You can't have some sort of a weird little ISP that ESPN hasn't partnered with.
ESPN 360 makes ISPs pay them
right.
to carry their stream.
Exactly.
It's the reverse of tiered internet,
so
where AT&T
sort of
wants to make Google pay them for the video to be delivered.
So if you're some Comcast hater and you've got some ISP alternative, you might not be able to watch the game streaming.
Or you might. ISPs have come to agreements, but yeah.
Yes. So there's that. There's a few apps that you can keep up on the games on, not necessarily streaming video, but just kind of make sure that you know what's going on. Or Twitter's great for things like this because
if you don't want to be spoiled about World Cup games, if you're like recording them at home on your DVR,
don't look at Twitter. And of course, Twitter is, if you haven't noticed already, and I would be kind of surprised because it's been a trending topic for a while. If you hashtag World Cup, that's #WorldCup, you get a cute little soccer ball by your tweet.
That's so stupid.
And it's so stupid, but I kind of want to...
That's so stupid, I'm going to do it right now.
I kind of want to come up with a reason. Well, during the USA-UK game tomorrow, which I'm definitely watching, I'll do a little hashtag World Cup and I'll get my little soccer ball, which is kind of like, you know, it's kind of that Foursquare thing where you get the...
So what is it? Hashtag World Cup?
Yeah.
All right, I'm doing #WorldCup, and then what? And so when I see my post
That's
comes up,
to do.
It'll have a soccer ball.
You'll have
to it.
A little soccer ball, and you'll feel kind of dumb.
Yeah, I'm going to feel real dumb right now.
But
there
you know what? You and about...
I don't see a soccer... Oh, there it is.
Okay.
It didn't load right away.
It takes a millisecond
It was too many milliseconds.
Yeah, so World Cup, that's fun. And not only is it fun, but it's getting quite a bit of traffic usage online. It's getting quite a bit of traffic usage.
It's the busiest news day since President Obama's inauguration.
So that was a pretty big day, certainly in the U.S. anyway. So Akamai, on a bunch of news-based sites, like 900 of them or something. So this is not all the sites in the world, but 900 of news-based sites. Akamai says, today marked the biggest traffic day. And the previous record was Obama's inauguration.
Yep.
How about that? I mean, World Cup is a really, really big deal.
It's because the U.S. people are actually interested now. So they're boosting the numbers.
Sure. It's going to be a big game tomorrow.
The USans, as I call the residents of the U.S.
Very excited about it. I think soccer is probably one of the things that all countries in the world agree on more than anything else.
Almost now. Yeah.
Just that they all love football.
And ESPN 3D launched today. Yay. If you are one of the 12 people with a, with a 3D TV and DirecTV and have paid for the 3D package.
That is a very narrow Venn diagram.
World Cup.
Right. So how many people is, yeah, you got to have a 3D, how many people is this, like two, three?
Raise your hands in the chat room if you're one of those people.
It's like a 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon separation.
Yeah. And then, of course, Monday, E3 kicks off.
Yay!
Sarah and I will be right here in this very cottage on Monday morning. But before that, at 9:30, Leo and Brushwood will be bringing you special exclusive coverage of Project Natal before the Microsoft press conference. Then at 10 a.m. Pacific, when the Microsoft press conference kicks off, Sarah and I will be doing our commentary, running commentary, watching the live blogs, telling you what's happening in the announcement. And then after that's over, back to Leo and Schwood. They'll be walking the show floor, talking to people about what Microsoft announced, getting some reactions. They'll be doing that all day Tuesday as well. So complete E3 coverage. If you want to know what's going on and you're not in L.A., right here at twit.tv, live.twit.tv. And then, of course, Tuesday is the Nintendo press conference at 9 and Sony. We won't be live blogging those
or commenting
on them because nobody is really expecting those to be as big as the Natal one.
Right. Money's the big keynote.
All right, on to the emails to TNT at twit.tv. I want to make sure I get it right. We got one from Daniel who says, I just read this and I'm disgusted.
What did he read?
As an Australian, I think this even trumps the internet filter. I hope this makes the mainstream news so that people can see how little K-Rudd thinks of our privacy.
What happened?
And it's a ZDNet article about how Australia now would like the government to require ISPs to record browsing history.
What?
For all of the customers.
What? Get out of town.
Yeah.
That's a terrible idea.
The Attorney General's department yesterday confirmed that it has been in discussions with the industry on implementing a data retention regime in Australia, requiring companies to provide internet access to log and retain customers' private web browsing history for a certain period of time for law enforcement access.
Okay, so law enforcement access. Got it. Winky, winky. That's not a good enough reason. I don't want my browsing history to be recorded by anyone. Too embarrassing.
Yeah, I mean, that's a presumption of guilt, I think. Yeah. And you know what? If you want to get somebody's browsing history, there's other ways to go about getting it. And there's ways if you have a warrant to come in and say, well, let's get that particular person's data stream or whatever. If you have to, right. Somebody's a terrorist or a child pornographer or something, go after them. But don't just say, let's record every single person in the country's browsing history.
And that way we've already got it. So when somebody does something wrong, we've got it already. We just have to sift through some stuff. Right. I can't imagine anybody being okay with this. What is in the water down there, Australia?
I'm so glad
government.
I don't run an ISP. In Australia, especially.
Oh, well, I wouldn't want to really at all.
Yeah, probably not.
You're kind of a headache. All right, another email. This is from Paul. He says, in a discussion at work today, how long do you think it'll be before AT&T opens up the front-facing camera on the new iPhone 4 to spy on customers in the same vein as opening the webcam on the MacBook or customer support did on the Dell? Just an idea. Would like to hear your thoughts on this. Enjoy the show.
That's totally what they're doing. They're going to spy on all of us.
Front-facing camera is a spy tool.
See, like on Australia,
Mission Impossible 5.
Where they're trying to get everybody's browsing history, in the U.S., they're just going to be spying on you all the time.
That's all it is.
Because your front-facing camera will be in your pocket, and they'll get all kinds of great pictures.
Pelvis?
What would they get?
I don't know.
Lint?
I don't know.
While you're looking, while you're surfing the web, they just get a picture of your face?
This is what I call paranoia.
Yeah. That's what mine would look like. I would just be blank. There'd just be blank
just
space.
Like AT&T, I could just send you a picture of myself. Why do you have to be looking at me all the time?
Cleaning grease off my screen.
All right, we got to wrap this up. But we got a very interesting, actually dozens of people sending in revisions of the Tech News Today album art. Because I had grown a beard. And so Brian says, posted one today. We're going to show his, but they all look pretty much like that.
Now, it's a lovely picture of you, Tom. You look great. Why is the beard kind of this gravelly?
That's pretty much what it looks like, yeah.
Well, but see, I'm sitting right across from you, and your beard matches the hair. This is all the same color. Carpet and drapes, if we can all stay above the neck.
Okay.
Right? Not in the picture. It's a little different.
Yeah.
But A for effort.
Yeah, that's all right. They all pretty much look like that, though.
B Beards are weird.
That's beards are just right. Weird. Beards are awesome.
Yeah.
Until I shave this one.
Yeah.
Then they suck again.
Yeah. At least you like it.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for listening or watching, however you consumed this podcast. We will be back on Monday with Leo and Schwood wrapping up their Monday E3 coverage. So check us out there. You can find us online at twit.tv/TNT. You can email us, TNT@twit.tv, or give us a call. Leave us a voicemail at 260-TNT-SHOW. We'll see you next time.